डॉक्टर योगेश पावड़े. आई वेलकम यू टू दिस नेक्स्ट सेशन इन लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन जेनेटिक्स एंड मॉलिकुलर बायोलॉजी. आफ्टर फिनिशिंग डीएनए रेप्लिकेशन, डीएनए रिपेयर, ट्रांसक्रिप्शन, वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट ट्रांसलेशन मैकेनिज्म्स एंड वेरियस फैक्टर्स इनहिबिटर्स रिलेटेड टू ट्रांसलेशन. कमिंग टू ट्रांसलेशन इन यूकैरियोट्स, विल सी फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल व्हाट आर द स्टेप्स ऑफ ट्रांसलेशन. The process of translation can be divided into following steps, that is activation of amino acids, initiation, elongation and termination. So these four steps are there in a process of translation. Now let us go to the first step, that is activation of amino acids or formation of amino acid tRNA. There are three sites in this enzyme. One is for tRNA, another one is for ATP, and the third one is for the amino acid for which it is specific. So later on, this enzyme is going to charge this tRNA with the specific amino acid, right? So this is an enzyme, that is glycine tRNA synthetase, which is taken as an example. The amino acid needs to be activated before they can be incorporated in a protein polypeptide by amino acyl tRNA synthetase. So this amino acyl tRNA synthetase will charge the particular tRNA with a given specific amino acid. So we have taken this glycine tRNA synthetase, and this can be any out of the 20 tRNA synthetases available. There are enzymes which are specific for a particular L amino acid and also for the tRNA. There are at least 20 different tRNAs that we have already discussed, and 20 different amino acyl tRNA synthetases also in a protein synthesizing system. These enzymes vary in molecular size, subunit and amino acid composition also, because they are very specific. So everything will be different, like molecular size, subunit or amino acid composition. There is at least one or sometimes two specific enzymes also for a given amino acid. This very high dual specificity of amino acyl tRNA synthetase is due to the high selectivity in terms of acceptance of the amino acid to be activated. So if this amino acid, that is glycine here, this enzyme is specific for glycine, okay, because the site is specific for glycine, and this site specificity for glycine makes it selective for glycine only, right? So this high selectivity is for the amino acid to be activated. Secondly, this site which is specific for a given structure of tRNA, which is specific for glycine, okay, so this enzyme is specific for glycine tRNA also. The tRNA which is going to be charged with the glycine, it has a specific structure. So this site is specific, so this enzyme is going to be specific for both amino acid as well as tRNA. So it has a very high dual specificity. Amino acid is attached to tRNA, and the recognition of the specific codon on mRNA is due entirely to tRNA. Now the recognition part is only attributable to the tRNA and not the amino acid. Sometimes the amino acids can be incorrectly activated, and those incorrectly activated amino acids cannot be incorporated into the given peptide. So those incorrectly activated amino acids will be hydrolyzed and they will not be incorporated. So what are the steps in activation of amino acid? This reaction requires amino acid, tRNA and ATP. First an intermediate will be formed, and later on the transfer of amino acyl group to tRNA will constitute the next step. And the overall reaction is, in the amino acyl tRNA, the alpha carboxylic group, see here, the alpha carboxylic group of amino acid is going to remain esterified with 3' OH of the 3' terminal adenosine on acceptor arm of tRNA. We have seen a structure of tRNA, there is acceptor arm, and there is a sequence of CCA, and the 3' OH of the A, that is adenosine, will accept the carboxylic group of amino acid, and that is very specific for the given amino acid. The hydrolysis of pyrophosphate, which is required for charging of tRNA, will drive the reaction to completion, and that is irreversible, because two high energy phosphate bonds will be used by conversion of ATP to pyrophosphate, and that's why the reaction is irreversible. As each tRNA forms an amino acyl tRNA with specific amino acids. And the codon-anticodon reactions bring the amino acid to ribosomes in a particular sequence depending on the codon sequence in mRNA. Coming to initiation steps, the initiation of translation may be divided arbitrarily into following steps. These are four steps. First step is dissociation of ATS into 60S and 40S subunits. Now these two subunits are separated and the 40S subunit will be involved in formation of 43S pre-initiation complex. After the 43S pre-initiation complex is formed, when it combines with mRNA, it forms 48S initiation complex. And after the 48S initiation complex is formed, the 60S subunit which was split in the first step is going to come back and join it. Combination of 48S initiation complex and 60S subunit will form a 80S initiation complex, and this complex will lead to the elongation stage. So these are the four steps of initiation. Coming to the first step, that is dissociation of ribosome. So before the initiation process starts, the 80S ribosome will dissociate into 40S and 60S subunit. As I have already mentioned that 40S will be involved in synthesis of 43S pre-initiation complex. The two initiation factors, first of all ELF3 and ELF1A, are going to bind to the newly dissociated 40S subunit, not to 60S subunit. Now it is out of the picture. So this binding of initiation factors ELF3 and ELF1A will prevent reassociation of 60S and 40S subunit, because after dissociation also 60S and 40S can reassociate again to form 80S subunit. So keep them separated by two initiation factors, that is ELF3 and ELF1A, and binding of ELF3 and ELF1A also enhance the binding of other translation initiation factors to associate with 40S. Which are they? These are ELF5 and ELF1. So ELF3 and ELF1A will enhance binding of ELF1 and ELF5, and it will prepare 40S subunit for synthesis of 43S pre-initiation complex. This process involves the binding of GTP with ELF2. Now there is a role of ternary complex which is going to bind to 40S subunit with initiation factors so as to synthesize 43S pre-initiation complex. So this process involves the binding of GTP with ELF2. This GTP bound to ELF2 is a binary complex, and this binary complex will bind to a tRNA. The first amino acid which is going to be incorporated is methionine. So the methionine tRNA will bind to binary complex to form a ternary complex. And this ternary complex, when gets bound to 40S subunit with 4 initiation factor, it will form 43S pre-initiation complex. And this 43S pre-initiation complex is stabilized by ELF3 and ELF1A. These two are going to stabilize this 43S pre-initiation complex. In eukaryotes, the ELF2 is the controlling factor in protein synthesis initiation, because this ELF2 is bound to GTP, and the first tRNA which will be involved in translation mechanism, it is going to control the protein synthesis initiation. And this ELF2 is a heterotrimer and consists of 3 subunits, that is alpha, beta and gamma. Out of these 3, alpha is most important because ELF2 is phosphorylated by at least 4 different protein kinases, namely HCR, PKR, PERK and GCN2. And these kinases are activated when a cell is under stress, maybe some sort of infection, viral infection, heat shock, or maybe metabolic disturbances are there, like carbohydrate and protein deprivation is there. Okay, and because of that, the ELF2 alpha is activated, it is phosphorylated by protein kinases, and it will synthesize necessary proteins to combat viral infection, heat stroke, etc. This is how ELF2 is going to control protein synthesis initiation step. So it is a step which is going to control protein synthesis initiation. Now coming to the formation of 48S initiation complex. So up to this step we have only 43S pre-initiation complex. So binding of mRNA with 43S pre-initiation complex is necessary to form the 48S initiation complex. The binding is facilitated by 5' methylated cap. We have discussed various functions of 5' methylated cap and poly A tail also in post-transcriptional modifications. So you can revisit and understand the functions of 5' methylated cap there. This binding is facilitated by 5' methylated cap, which needs a cap binding protein complex, and the cap binding protein complex constitute ELF4E, ELF4G and ELF4A. ELF means eukaryotic initiation factor. So ELFE 4G and ELF4A are going to constitute cap binding protein complex, and this complex is going to bind the 5' methylated cap through ELF4E protein. This ELF4E protein is going to bind to 5' methylated cap, and it acts as a bridge for ELF4G and ELF4A. Then ELF4A and ELF4B bind and reduce the complex secondary structure of 5' end of the mRNA by helicase activity through ATP hydrolysis providing energy. So ELF4B is going to bind 5' methylated cap binding protein complex, and it will hydrolyze ATP, and it will reduce the complex secondary structure of 5' end of mRNA by helicase activity. The association of mRNA with 43S pre-initiation complex will synthesize this 48S initiation complex, which will have 40S7 in it. Then the initial 4 ELF1A, ELF3, 5 and 1, and addition of ELF2, GTP and tRNA by ternary complex, and this mRNA with ELFE, G, A and B is now have constituted 48S initiation complex. In a simplified picture, this is how it looks like, the 48S initiation complex. Now let us see how this stage is regulated. Okay, so the ELF4E is the most important factor here, which is going to recognize the cap of 5' methylated end of mRNA that we have seen. Okay, and it is the rate limiting step in protein synthesis. Will breach 4G and 4A, and after that B will come, and it will hydrolyze, and it will reduce the complex structure of 5' methylated end of mRNA. Okay, and this is the rate limiting step. Like in insulin or other mitogenic factors like IGF-1, PDGF, interleukin-2, angiotensin-2, these are going to phosphorylate ELF4E and increase protein synthesis. Like in case of initiation, we have seen that ELF2 is a regulating factor. Here ELF4E is a regulating factor in synthesis of 48, which is involved in synthesis of 48S initiation complex by binding to mRNA. After formation of 48 initiation complex, it searches for precise initiation codon, that is AUG, for methionine, and this is determined by Kozak consensus sequence in eukaryotes, and in bacteria it is Shine-Dalgarno sequence. So in eukaryote it is Kozak consensus sequence, and these interactions are primarily mediated by ELF4G, which binds both directly to 3' end of the mRNA and poly A binding protein that codes the poly A tail. So this 43S pre-initiation complex has bound to mRNA, and that binding is not only to 5' end cap, but it is going to bind to poly A tail also through the agency of ELF4G, because this ELF4G will bind to 3' end of mRNA as well as the poly A tail through poly A tail binding protein, which is going to coat the poly A tail. Why is this important? Because as a result of these interactions, the RNA is being held in a circular configuration with 5 prime end and 3 prime end of the molecule, that is mRNA molecule, in close proximity. So this is how it will look like. This 43S pre-initiation complex will bind to this circular mRNA molecule because it is made circular by interaction between ELF4G and the poly A tail. The ELF4G has bound to 5 prime cap through ELF4E and the ELF4G is now bound to 3 prime end of mRNA, and the poly A binding protein has coated the poly A tail and made the mRNA molecule circular in shape, and this circular shape will help in further steps of translation. The translation initiation factors: poly A tail holds eukaryotic mRNAs in circle. In this way, the poly A tail contributes to the efficiency of eukaryotic translation, and this was discussed in brief when we discussed significance of poly A tail in a lecture on post-transcriptional modifications. In addition to binding to 5 prime end of eukaryotic mRNA, the initiation factors that prepare the mRNA are also associated with 3 prime end of mRNA. These interactions are going to enhance several steps of initiation, including ELF4E binding to the mRNA cap and large subunit recruitment. Importantly, the interactions of ELF4G and poly A binding protein with the mRNA are maintained through multiple rounds of translation. So, the circular shape of mRNA is going to help the machinery to be there to undergo multiple rounds of translation. In addition, this circular shape, this mRNA configuration has added benefit of locating recently terminated ribosomes near the AUG, presumably enhancing reinitiation of the translation process. In this step of 48S initiation complex, ELF4E has the most important role because it recognizes cap of 5' methylated end of mRNA, so it is the rate limiting step in protein synthesis. The association of ELF4G with 4E is particularly important. We have seen that 4G is circularizing the mRNA molecule. The overall level of translation in the cell is controlled at this step by a family of protein that compete with ELF4G binding, called as ELF4E binding proteins. Like insulin and other mitogenic factors, like insulin like growth factor 1, platelet derived growth factor, interleukin 2, angiotensin 2, these are going to phosphorylate ELF4E and it increases. And those factors, after phosphorylation of ELF4E, are going to increase the protein synthesis. The RNA helicase activity of ELF4A is augmented by ELF4B. We have seen that after the 4B binds to 4A, it unwinds the secondary structure of 5 prime cap of mRNA molecule. So, the RNA helicase activity of ELF4A is going to be augmented by ELF4B, unwind the secondary structure that might have formed at the 5 prime end of the mRNA molecule and which may hinder. So, it should be reduced. The removal of secondary structure is critical because 5 prime end of the mRNA must be unstructured to bind to the smaller subunits. Coming to the fourth step, that is formation of ATS initiation complex. The ELF2 carries GTP. After the 48S initiation complex is formed, this ELF2 and ELF5 will interact. Because ELF2 is complex with GTP and ELF5 has GTPase activity, the hydrolysis of GTP will occur, okay, and the hydrolysis will, and this reaction will result in release of all the initiation factors bound to 48 initiation complex, and which are then are going to be recycled. The 48 initiation complex binds to 60S, which was free after ribosomal dissociation to form ATS initiation complex on hydrolysis of GTP. And now ATS ribosomal complex is ready for protein synthesis. So this is how ATS sub unit looks like, okay, and one tRNA molecule with methionine is found at P site when ATS ribosomal complex is ready. This is 60 S sub unit and this is 40 S sub unit. The ATS complex has two receptor site, that is P site and A site. The P site or peptidyl site, at this point the methionine tRNA is on the P site, and on this side the growing peptide chain will grow. And there is A site also, that is also called as amino acyl site. At this point it is free. When ATS complex is formed, that is free, the new incoming tRNA with the amino acid to be added next is taken up at this site, and the tRNA binds with ribosome through the pseudouridine arm. Coming to the elongation steps in translation, the elongation is a cyclical process on the ribosome in which one amino acid is added to the nascent polypeptide chain, The peptide sequence is determined by codons present in mRNA. It requires elongation factors. Those are ELF1A, ELF2. And the steps involved in elongation are mainly three: the binding of new amino acyl tRNA to A site, peptide bond formation, and translocation. Now we will move on to the first step of elongation, that is binding of new amino acyl tRNA to the A site, because the first tRNA, that is methionine tRNA, is already there in ATS subunit. So in elongation step, the first step is binding of new amino acyl tRNA to the A site. In the ribosomal initiation complex, the P site is already occupied by methionine tRNA and the A site is free. The fidelity of protein synthesis depends on having the correct amino acyl tRNA in the A site as per codon reading. So the next codon is here. It will be read, and the appropriate tRNA with the complementary amino acid for the sequence will be coming in to occupy this acceptor site. This elongation factor 1A forms a ternary complex with GTP and the entering amino acyl tRNA. This complex allows the amino acyl tRNA to enter A site. This complex will allow the new amino acyl tRNA to enter the A site. The GTP is hydrolyzed to give energy, and this is catalyzed by an active site on the ribosome, and this will release ELF1A GDP and PI, and the ELF1A GDP is converted again to ELF1A GTP by recycling it, and the other soluble protein factors and GTP is involved in recycling ELF1A GTP complex. The alpha amino group of the new amino acyl tRNA in the A site is going to combine with carboxylic group of methionine tRNA occupying the P site. The growing peptide chain occupies A site after it is transferred and combines with the new amino acid at the A site, and the naked free tRNA at the P site. The reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme peptidyl transferase. And this enzyme is a component of 28S RNA of the 60S ribosomal subunit. Now you will understand why binding of 60S ribosomal subunit is important when it has formed 48S initiation complex. So without 60S ribosomal subunit, there will be no peptidyl transferase activity and amino acid won't be added. And this peptidyl transfer is an example of a ribozyme where RNA acts as the enzyme and there is a direct role of RNA in protein synthesis. So this is a ribozyme, and because the amino acid on the amino acyl tRNA is already activated, the reaction does not require any further energy. Coming to the third step of elongation, that is translocation, the tRNA is fixed at the P site, attached by its anticodon and having no amino acid, that means there is open CCATL and is bound to the exit site. EF to GTP complex hydrolyzed to EF to GDP, the energy from hydrolysis moves the mRNA forward by one codon, leaving the A site free to receive another ternary complex of a new amino acid as per codon and repeat the cycle of elongation. At this point, EF2 binds to and displaces the peptide tRNA from the A site to the P site, and at the same time, the deacylated free tRNA is on the E site from which the tRNA leaves the ribosome. When the desired protein molecule is synthesized, a stop codon or the terminating codon appears at the A site of mRNA. Which are the stop codons? UAA, UAG and UGA, and there is no tRNA with an anticodon capable of recognizing such a terminal signal of stop codon. The releasing factor RF1 recognizes that the stop codon has come to A site. This releasing factor will bind to stop codon and it will make the protein synthesizing machine aware of the stop codon at acceptor site. This protein factor RF1 is a complex consisting of another releasing factor RF3 with bound GTP. This complex, with the help of peptidyl transferase, will bring about hydrolysis of the bond between the peptide and the tRNA occupying the P site, and this energy is provided by hydrolysis of GTP. So the peptidyl transferase will hydrolyze the bond between the peptide and tRNA, and it will release the free polypeptide from the complex. The hydrolysis will release the synthesized peptide chain, mRNA and tRNA from the P site. And the ATS ribosome now dissociates into 60S and 40S subunit, which are then again recycled for the next round of translation. Now coming to the inhibitors of translation. These are inhibitors or maybe antibiotics or some chemicals which inhibit the translation. First of all, let us see what is streptomycin. It interferes with the binding of FMET tRNA to ribosomes and thereby inhibiting the initiation process in bacteria. It also leads to misreading of mRNA. Next is puromycin. It inhibits the release of nascent polypeptide chain before their synthesis is complete. It binds to A site on ribosome and inhibits the entry of amino acid tRNA. So puromycin and streptomycin both are inhibitors of initiation step of translation. Next is tetracycline. It binds to 30S subunit and inhibits the binding of amino acyl tRNA. Again, it inhibits the initiation process. Ricin and abrin, these lectins inhibit protein synthesis by preventing amino acyl tRNA from binding to A site. This operates in eukaryotes and inactivates eukaryotic 28S ribosomal RNA. So, peptidyl transferase activity will be absent. In eukaryotes also, it will have various side effects in protein synthesis. Alpha sarcin, this is a toxin. This is a toxic RNAs that prevent amino acyl tRNA binding by cleaving a single phosphodiester bond in 28S rRNA. Chloramphenicol, it inhibits the peptidyl transferase activity of 50S subunit. Thus, it inhibits the process of elongation. Cyclohexamide, it inhibits the peptidyl transferase activity of 60S subunit in eukaryotes. It also inhibits the elongation process. Erythromycin, it binds to 50S subunit and inhibits the translocation process. Diphtheria toxin, a protein toxin produced by Corynebacterium diphtheriae, it binds to EF2 in eukaryotes and blocks the translocation process. Parsomycin, this inhibits the peptidyl transferase and release factor dependent termination. This was all regarding various inhibitors of translation. We have seen inhibitors of all three stages of translation, that is initiation, elongation and translocation or termination. These are the references used for compilation of this presentation. You can use this for your further studies. Thank you so much for watching the long video. Hope you all have subscribed to the channel. If you are not, kindly subscribe to the channel and hit the like button and kindly share it. Thank you so much once again.